Good evening, everyone. It's great to see all you here. Glad to be here. Hope you're glad to be here. It's a fortunate thing that we can come together, even amidst all the chaos that's happening right now. And just hearts full for those people, everyone involved, and just, yeah, it's sad. But thank God we can gather together. Thank God we can be here. So let's rejoice. Let's worship. If you'd like to stand, if you'd like to sit, however you want to worship, you know, use this time just to focus on the Lord and just to sing praise to Him. So, amen. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this time. Lord, we thank you for, God, your word. We thank you for, God, just your the truth, God, that you have, God, the Lord, the power that we have in you and the truth, God, that lies in your love. And God, we just want to say thank you. We want to praise you this evening. In Jesus' name.
I saw Satan fall like lightning. I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe in signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Yes, I do. Still the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. Yeah, my praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. Whoa. Come together, sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father, our God. We'll finish what He started. Yes, our God, we'll finish what He started. This is my testimony. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. You're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. was your fault, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind. Shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Down before him, for he's Lord of all. Sing hallelujah, Christ is risen. Come on, let's sing together. Oh, what a Savior, isn't he wonderful? Sing hallelujah. Hallelujah. your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs. So we pour out our praise to you only.
And God, we just thank you, God, that Lord, we can make a joyful noise to you tonight, God, that we can sing your praises, God, in peace and safety, God. And we just want to say thank you. Say thank you for your grace and your mercy that has rewritten our stories, God. We know, Lord, we are secure with you, God. And that we thank you, we love you, we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hello, everybody. How are you? All right, there we go. Well, welcome. So we're going to continue on our study through the book of Amos, one of the major minor prophets. The more I read this letter, the more I am just humbled by this humble sheep breeder. He wouldn't even call himself a shepherd. He says, I'm a breeder of sheep. I won't even take the term shepherd because I just get a sense that he felt that he wasn't really worthy to take that term. You know, in chapter 7, he described himself. He says, I was no prophet, nor was I even the son of a prophet, but I was a sheep breeder, a tender of sycamore fruit. So I don't know what a tender of sycamore fruit is. I didn't know sycamore trees bore fruit, but he says, but the Lord took me as I followed the flock. And the Lord said to me, go prophesy to my people Israel. And Amos wasn't even of the nation of Israel. He was of the nation of the tribes of Judah. He was from the southern tribes. And God says, well, I'm pulling you out of your surroundings down there, and I'm sending you up to my people up north. And he's like, you didn't even send me to my own people, Lord. You sent me to those guys up north. And so just an amazing, humble man chosen by the Lord to go speak to his people. I can relate to that. I was just a breaker of glass. I was a glazer. And you know, the Lord he can take anybody. You know, none of us are special. The Lord can use each and every one of you today. He can put a calling upon your life and send you to speak into somebody's life. Amen? Do you believe that? Yes, you should. So let's pray. Does anybody, do you need a Bible? Does everybody have their Bibles? And we'll open up to the book of Amos chapter 3 tonight. So, Father, we come before you, Lord, in prayer to thank you, God, for this humble man that you chose to give your word to your people, a warning to draw them back to you. As we'll see in your scripture, Lord, your desire was that they would simply return to you. And Lord, I believe that's the call today as well, Lord. If we've strayed, maybe we don't even know it. Maybe we think we're right with you, God, but you've been speaking to our hearts. And so, Lord, I pray today, tonight, Lord, that you truly would, Lord, just commune with us tonight. Lord, that we would have that intimacy of relationship with you, and Lord, that we would walk out of here changed, or at least, Lord, a spark or a thought or a something stirring in our souls and our hearts, Lord, to draw us closer to you. Lord, may you be glorified. May you be worshipped and set on high, God, above all things, Lord, that you may be worshipped tonight, Lord, and all of our days, Lord Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen. So, let me take a drink here and we'll get right into it. My plan is to go through 3 chapters tonight. And so, there's a lot in here. So, it says Amos chapter 3. It says, hear this word that the Lord has spoken against you, O children of Israel, against the whole family which I brought up from the land of Egypt, saying, you only have I known all of all the families of the earth. Therefore, I will punish you for all of your iniquities. Wow. Hear the word of the Lord. He says, I'm speaking to you, my children of Israel. And the reason I'm speaking to you is because I have chosen you as a special people to me. I have brought you up out of the land of Egypt, redeemed you from bondage. And because of that, because we have this relationship, the Lord says, I will not let you go unpunished. Who wants to hear that from the Lord? Because I have saved you from your sin, I have bore your sins on the cross, therefore, because I love you so much, I will not let you go unchastised for your sin. You see, that's a good father, isn't it? That's a good parent that looks at their children and says, because I love you so much and I brought you into this world, I'm not going to let you just go and get away with everything that you've been doing. No. I will chasten you for it. You see, now we got to understand, we're in the Old Testament, okay? So just understand, they're living under the law, okay? He says, For you only have I known of all the families of the earth. God is making a clear statement here. Israel, I have only revealed myself to you. I have not revealed myself. You remember in the previous chapters, he judged the nations. He said, for three transgressions and four, Damascus and Gaza and Tyre and Edom and Ammon. And all these other countries, right? God addressed their issues, but then he also turned and said, now I'm going to deal with yours. Because out of all these nations of people, I have only revealed myself to you, right? And God says, you will be a special people unto me, and I will be your God. And he says, therefore, I will punish you for your iniquities. And so we got to ask ourselves, as Christians, do you remember what God has done for you? Do you remember? Do you think about it? Do you consider it often? How God saved you from your sin? You remember where you were before? And you thought that was living life, but you were dying? And God redeemed you from that and gave you light and life? And now you know what real living is? You see, sometimes we get complacent in our walk and we tend to forget. You know, and we look back on that old life and we start glorifying it. Remembering, oh, you remember the good times we had? Yeah. And do you remember the morning after that? Do you remember that? Yeah, it wasn't so good, was it? No. Remember how you lost your job? Anyway, he says, I want you to remember it because I'm the one which I brought you up from the land of Egypt. I was going to Google that and just see how many times the Lord said that very thing to the nation of Israel and Judah. I think quite a bit. This is a common phrase with God. I brought you up from the land of Egypt. And then he goes on in verse 3, he says, can two walk together unless they are agreed? Will a lion roar in the forest when he has no prey? Will a young lion cry out of his den? If he has caught nothing, will a bird fall into a snare on the earth where there is no trap for it? Will a snare spring up from the earth if it has caught nothing at all? If a trumpet is blown in a city, will not the people be afraid? If there is calamity in a city, will not the Lord have done it? Actually, the answer to all those questions is, duh. Of course. If a lion roars in the forest when he has no prey. Yes, he's hungry. He's calling out. Will a young lion cry out of his den if he has caught nothing? Yes, those little cubs, they cry out. I'm hungry. I'm hungry. This is a no-duh kind of question. Will birds just fall to the earth if they haven't been caught in a snare? Well, of course not. These are no-duh questions, right? You know what I'm saying there? And so, but what he's saying is, if there is no calamity in the city, if there is calamity in the city, will not the Lord have done it? You've got to understand, in this time period, right, they live under the law, and God said, you're required to do obedience. And when you do not do obedience, there are consequences for that. I will bring troubles upon you for your disobedience. And he said, so if there's trouble in the city, it's because the Lord is doing it. You know, he's speaking to his own people here. But I think the more important thing is in chapter or verse 3 there, can two walk together unless they are agreed? And the answer is no, they cannot. They'll argue and fight all along the way. Boy, we see that in our nation today, can't we? We don't walk together with each other anymore. We're so divided, we can't agree on anything. We'll argue just to argue. That's where our nation is today. But to take it home, the Lord is speaking to each and every one of us. He's saying, can you and I walk together unless we agree? And the answer is, no, we can't, Lord. So the reality is, if we call ourselves Christians, that means we agree with God regarding everything. Everything. Is that the case in your life? When God says, I don't approve of that, do you say, well, I do. I think that's okay, Lord. The Lord says, no, I don't think that that's right. That's immoral behavior. And we say, oh, no, that's fine. You created us that way. Are we in agreement with God and his word? You see, that's what God's saying. Are you in agreement with this? If we're going to walk together as Christians and creator, then I have to agree with what God's word tells me. I don't get to pick and choose. That's the statement he's making here. Can two walk together unless they are agreed? And so we have a question to ask ourselves. Do I agree with everything that God tells me? Do I agree with his word? Even when I don't like it. Goes on, though. He says, surely the Lord God does nothing unless he reveals his secrets to his prophets. A lion has roared. Who will not fear? The Lord God has spoken. Who can but prophesy? So surely the Lord God does nothing unless he reveals his secret to his servants and prophets. I think this can be taken out of context here. I think people could say, see, if God hasn't spoken it, then he's not going to do it. If we haven't heard about it, he's not going to do it. That's not what's going on. Actually, it's not really true, because God does things without ever telling us about them. He does a lot of things. I'll give you just one perfect example. In Ephesians chapter 3, God did not reveal to any of his prophets that he was going to include the Gentiles in his church. And as a matter of fact, that he was actually going to kind of turn it over to the Gentiles. Did you know that? Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 7 says that the revelation that the Gentiles would be heirs with the Jews in the church was not revealed to any of the prophets. It was a New Testament revelation come through Jesus Christ. And so if we take this in blank, just as it's written, we can take it out of context. But I will say this. In context with what's going on concerning judgment, God never keeps that a secret. In context with God's judgment, he never keeps that a secret. He always lays it out on the table for everyone to see, everyone to hear, always. God will always tell us when he's about to judge the nations. Always. Do you know why? Because he wants to give us opportunity to turn from our sin and turn to him. You know, God's doing amazing things all around us. This coronavirus thing, who's made sense out of all that? I have no idea what God's doing, but I know he's doing something. And I suspect in the back of my mind that he's using it to draw people to himself. In some way or another, God will use this in a person's life to draw them to him. that they might be saved. I can stand assured of that, but the rest of it, I haven't a clue. And so in verse 9, he says, proclaim in the palaces of Ashdod. Those are the, that's a, it's a Philistine city, okay? Ashdod is the capital of the Philistines. He says, proclaim in the palaces of Ashdod, in the palaces of the land of Egypt, and say, assemble in the mountains of Samaria, see great tumults in her midst, and the oppressed within her, for they do not know to do right, says the Lord. They who store up violence and robbery in their palaces. This is interesting. It says, so this is Amos saying, go tell the Philistines and the Egyptians about the sins of Israel and what's going on in their palaces. How they store up violence and robbery in the wealthy places, the palaces. He says, go tell our unsaved neighbors how our saved people are, what they're doing in their fancy homes. That's what he's saying here. I'm just paraphrasing. I'm a basic guy. So he says, go tell them. He says, you know why? Because those guys, my people, they do not know what is right. They do not know to do right. I find that's just crazy. Surely they know how to do right. God's given them his word. So what does that tell us? They're not reading it. They're not following it. If they don't know to do, you know, this is, a lot of people say, well, I don't believe in the Bible, but I will give you this. It's the best self-help book that's ever been written. I've heard that from unbelievers. Because everything, all the morals and the ethics that God establishes in here are good. These are right. There's no doubt about it. You can't disagree with it. But if you don't read it, if you don't follow it, then how would you know to do right? You'll make up your own system. And that's actually what the children of Israel have been doing. And he says, therefore, because of that, because they store up violence and robbery in their palaces, and they don't know how to do right anymore, God says, therefore, thus says the Lord God, an adversary shall be all around the land. He shall sap your strength from you, and your palaces shall be plundered. Thus says the Lord, as a shepherd takes from the mouth of a lion two legs or a piece of an ear, so shall the children of Israel be taken out, who dwell in Samaria, in the corner of a bed, and on the edge of a couch. What in the world is he talking about? Okay. Number one, he says, an adversary shall be all around the land. In Leviticus chapter 26, God told the children of Israel, he warned them, he says, when you fall from me, when you turn your back on me, all the people that you've driven out of this promised land, I will use them to chasten you. I will send them back into the land, and they will be your adversary. And so, sure enough, the nation of Assyria and the Egyptians and the Philistines and all of these other nations, that they're just a constant thorn in the side of Israel. And now they're coming back in. And God is raising up the nation of Assyria. At the time that Amos is speaking, they're growing. That nation of Assyria is growing stronger and stronger and stronger. But they're way off there in Iraq. They're way over there. And we're over here in Israel. And it's a time of prosperity. Everybody's doing well. We're doing good, right? And there's no fear. Oh, but it's coming. It's coming. And then he uses this analogy of how bad it's going to be. This part about a shepherd takes from the mouth of a lion two legs or a piece of an ear. You guys ever heard of that before? Actually, I have. In the book of Leviticus, it talks about it, in Deuteronomy as well. It speaks about, if I'm a shepherd and Jess gives me 10 of her lambs to care for, she's going on vacation, and she gives me some of her sheep to care for, and so I'm caring for these sheep. Well, meanwhile, a wolf comes in, and devours Jesse's sheep. Let's say three of them, eats three of them. Well, if Jess comes back, she goes, where's my sheep? I say, oh, a lion ate them. And she goes, really? How do I know? How do I know you just didn't sell them or eat them? Well, here's the deal. Under the law, right, or this guideline is actually, it says that if a lion comes and starts devouring the sheep, I'm to go and try to snatch a leg or an ear away from that lion so that I can prove to Jess, see, a lion ate your lamb. And by the way, I did my due diligence. I maybe not didn't fight him off, but I at least got a little bit of your lamb back to prove to you that I did do my job. I was caring for your sheep. And so he uses this analogy that, you see, because the children of Israel, guess what their job was to be? Shepherds over each other. And not only that, but they were to be a witness to these other nations as well. And so, but God is basically saying, you guys are showing up to me empty-handed. You didn't do your job. And he says, those who dwell in the Samaria in the corner of a bed, on the edge of a couch, hear and testify against the house of Jacob, says the Lord God, the God of hosts. He says, in the day I punish Israel for their transgressions, I will also visit destruction on the altars of Bethel, and the horns of the altar shall be cut off and fall to the ground. I will destroy the winter house along with the summer house, and the houses of ivory shall perish, and the great houses shall have an end, says the Lord. God says, because of your lack of diligence and due diligence in what I've called you to do, I am going to wipe you out. And also, you see what he's talking about here? He's talking about who has summer houses and winter houses and palaces of ivory? The plumber? Electrician? Ditch diggers? No. The affluent. People with wealth and position. Do those people not have responsibility within the nation? You know, our forefathers had that, right? And they looked at themselves and said, you know what? We have a responsibility. If we're going to be a nation, a free nation, then we, as those wealthy, affluent people, need to take responsibility upon ourselves to fight for this and to stand for what is right. You can name them. George Washington, Thomas Jefferson, Ben Franklin, John Adams. I mean, come on, give me a few more. John Henry. All these guys were men of position and wealth, and they realized they had a responsibility. Well, here in Israel at this time, guess what? They've forsaken all that responsibility. And God says, you know what? I'm going to hold you guys accountable. I'm going to destroy your winter houses, your summer houses, and your houses of ivory. Well, God's just picking on the rich. Yeah. Everybody's getting picked on here, poor and wealthy. But he says, I'm also going to visit destruction upon your altars at Bethel. We'll talk about Bethel a little bit later. You remember they set up an altar in Bethel and in Beersheba and also up in the city of Dan. And he says, I'm going to cut off the horns of those altars. That was supposed to be the symbol of strength. He says, I'm going to cut them off so they fall to the ground. I'm going to destroy all of that. And the great houses shall all have an end. Pretty powerful, huh? So that's chapter 3. And so in chapter 4, it says, hear this word, you cows of Bashan. Who are on the mountain of Samaria, who oppress the poor, who crush the needy, who say to your husbands, bring wine and let us drink. Okay, this is interesting. Do you know where the land of Bashan is? Bashan, so the capital city of Israel, the northern tribes, is Samaria. And about 10 miles north of Samaria was some of the best pasture land in all of the nation. And they would grow these these wonderful fat cows and strong bulls. These fat cows in Zechariah, it says the fatlings of Bashan. And even in the prophecy of Jesus Christ's crucifixion in Psalm chapter 22, it says, and the strong bulls of Bashan have surrounded me. Okay, so there's this word picture we're looking at, right? This land of prosperity where the cows eat and become fat and strong. Okay, you see it? And so this is Amos, this sheep breeder, turns and says to the women of Israel, and also, you know how I know it says women? That it's women he's talking to? Because they say to their husbands, bring us wine and let us drink. He's literally calling all the women of Israel a bunch of fat cows. That's insulting today, is it not? Well, it was insulting back then as well. Woe to you, all you cows of Bashan, who drink wine. And what's their sin? Because they oppress the poor and they crush the needy. You see, they have such an affluent life. They're such a comfortable life that they never lack for anything. They're well fed. And yet, in the midst of that, what do? They prey upon the poor and the needy. God says, I ain't going to let you get away with that. You're going to be held accountable for that. And it says, the Lord has sworn by his holiness. Oh my gosh. The Lord has sworn by his own holiness. You think he's serious? You think this is a serious matter? We're in deep water here, folks. This is not, we're not walking through the creek here. It's waist deep and rising. It's a serious matter. The Lord has sworn by his own holiness. He says, behold, the day shall come upon you, speaking to these wealthy people. He says, when he will take you away with fish hooks and your posterity with fish hooks, you will go out through broken walls, each one straight ahead of her, and you will be cast into Harmon, says the Lord. Now, I didn't do it, but in the halls of the British Museum, when you go there, and you're all going to go there, they have separated everything by empires. You go to the Babylonian Empire, the Persian Empire, the Egyptian Empire. Everything's separated by empires. And so you go to the Assyrian Empire. And there they took from the palaces of Nineveh, which is modern-day Mosul in Iraq. They're digging up the Assyrian palaces. The palace in Nineveh, they took these reliefs off the walls in the palaces. And one of the reliefs, I think it's 40 feet long, and it's about 8 or 10 feet tall, and it's mounted on the wall there, and it shows the sacking of Lachish, the city of Lachish, which is in Israel. I've been there. On a hill, they're excavating it too. It shows the sacking of Lachish, and the Assyrian army is leading out the captives of Israel with fish hooks in their jaws. Now, the Assyrians, I got to tell you, they were brutal. They were as violent as they come. They had no mercy or compassion for their victims or the nations that they conquered. And they would do either one thing, they would either run a hook through your nose here and bend it and then run it back with a pig line to another one, or else they would run a hook through your jaw right here and out the corner of your mouth, and they would bend it shut and then to the next guy and the next guy and the next guy and the next guy. Oh. Is that the one? I can't see the ropes, but. But God prophesied, and the reason they would do that is that your hands would be free. If I bind your hands up, you can't carry much. They want you to do all the work. You're going to carry out your own booty and take it back home to them. God prophesied it. He says they will take you away with fish hooks. You will go through broken walls. They tore down the walls of their cities and marched them out through those broken walls. And it says each one straight ahead of her. Just a line being led off into captivity. It's brutal. This is the message that's coming to these wealthy women. God says, this is the fate that's coming before you because of your horrible behavior. I wish they would have changed their ways. They didn't. They were led off captive with fish hooks in their jaws. And he says in verse 4, chapter 4, come to Bethel and transgress. At Gilgal, multiply transgression. Bring your sacrifices every morning, your tithes every three days. Offer a sacrifice of thanksgiving with leaven. Proclaim and announce the free will offerings. For this you love, you children of Israel, says the Lord God. What's he talking about there? He says, all right, Bethel. He says, come up to Bethel and transgress against me. You see, Bethel was a northern city. Where did God say he was to be worshipped? In Jerusalem. But meanwhile, they had set up Jeroboam. We'll actually go there, I think, in 2 Kings. I'll just tell you about it. In 2 Kings, it says Jeroboam. Jeroboam was when the kingdom was split from Solomon. Solomon's son Rehoboam, and then Jeroboam. The nation was divided because of Solomon's sin. The nation was divided. Jeroboam, 10 tribes went with him to the north. 2 tribes, Judah and Benjamin, stayed in the south. Well, Jeroboam, fearing that the people would go back to Jerusalem and worship at the temple, would turn and stay with Rehoboam in the south. And so rather than do that, he set up false temples. He set up one in Bethel, one in Samaria, and one in Dan. And one in Gilgal. And the people, he's like, it'd just be more convenient for you to go worship there. You don't need to go to Jerusalem. And then besides that, it says he set up priests of every class of people. He didn't follow the law of the sons of Aaron. He set them up of every class of people. Anybody could be a priest. Anybody. God says, no. Do we agree on this? Do you agree? Only the sons of Aaron. And it said, because of this, because of the sins of Jeroboam, it caused the people to be sin, to fall into sin as well. They compromised. So God says, well, hey, go up to Bethel and transgress there. Go up to Gilgal and multiply your transgressions there. And he talks about bring every morning your sacrifices. Under the law, they were to sacrifice a lamb every morning and a lamb every night. That was part of the sacrifices every day. They were to do this. And he says, but not only that, you were to bring your, it says here, your tithes every 3 days. Well, actually, according to the law, it was only supposed to be every 3 years. But now he says they're doing it every 3 days. And he says, and you offer sacrifices of thanksgiving with what? Leaven. Leaven is a picture of sin. It's yeast. He says, so you're bringing all your offerings coupled with sin. I don't know about you guys, but I'm guilty here. When I read this, I get very convicted. Because sometimes I come in here with knowing sin in my life, unrepented sin, and I go about my business here as pastor of the church. And when I walk out of here, I look and I go, that was worth nothing. God ain't going to honor that. That day's shot. Leading worship as a worship leader. Now tell me, you got to be honest, Matt. Sometimes leading worship, your mind is so far from God, you're thinking about pizza for lunch or how you got to get your car serviced or how are you going to fix those new puppies? You know, got those new puppies. And your mind is so far from God. You're not thinking about the Lord at all. And yet you're going through the motions. The people are singing wonderfully. And you're like, praise God, someone's worshiping. I'm off in left field somewhere. God, you know, right? It happens because we're human, see? This is who we are. Let's just be real about it. Sometimes we come into church here simply because I think I better be at church. And you got horrible sin. You just had a horrible argument with your wife on your way to church. Said again, Rocky says. Yeah. I mean, right? And you come in here and we act all holier than thou. And God's just looking down going, oh, come on. I love it when people come up and they say, you know, I'm not feeling it today. I'm just not there. I'm sorry, Pastor, but I'm just not there. Praise God. Let's not put on a face when we don't need to. God knows. God knows. So sometimes we just need to be honest with ourselves and with God and maybe with each other as well. You know, and God says, he says, and you guys do all this for this you love. You love your religion more than your relationship with me. You'd rather put on a false front for the sake of your buddies than to be right before me. That's hard, isn't it? Well, I've been there a time or two. Now, verse 6, he says, also, I gave you cleanness of teeth in all your cities and lack of bread in all your places, yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. Oh, what? Lord gave him a good dental? No. The reason you have cleanness of teeth is because you have nothing to eat. There's no reason to brush your teeth. You got no bread. You see it? I gave you cleanness of teeth and lack of bread in all your places. Yet, you have not returned to me. Remember that. So it started out with just, I'm going to take away your bread. And he says, I also withheld rain from you when there were still 3 months to the harvest. I made it rain on one city, withheld rain from another city. One part was rained upon, and where it did not rain, the part withered. So two or three cities wandered to another city to drink water. But they were not satisfied. Yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. Well, first of all, I took away your bread. And that didn't cause you to turn to me. So I took away the rain. And you know what? That didn't cause you to return to me either. So verse 9, I blasted you with blight and mildew. When your gardens increased, your vineyards, your fig trees, and your olive trees, the locusts devoured them. Yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. So I went one step even further, and I took away your wine, your vineyards, your fig trees, your olives. So now you got no bread, no water, no wine, no olives, no fig trees, and yet you still haven't returned to me. What's a loving God to do? Well, let's see. All right, that ain't going to get your attention. I sent a plague among you. And after the manner of Egypt, your young men I killed with a sword, along with your captive horses. I made the stench of your camps come up into your nostrils, yet you have not returned. He says, I sent a plague and war upon you, and even that did not draw you back to me. Okay, verse 11, I overthrew some of you as God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah. He says, and you were like a firebrand plucked from the burning, yet you have not returned to me, says the Lord. He says, I started burning your cities to try to get your attention. Nope, that didn't work either. Therefore, thus says the Lord, this I will do to you, O Israel, because I will do this to you, prepare to meet your God, O Israel. Whoa. Did you see how God began? He began slowly. I'll just take away your bread. Will that get your attention? You know, and then you see as God just kind of ramps it up, worse upon worse upon worse upon worse, to try and get you to, has God been speaking to you and you just aren't listening? And now all of a sudden your life is just a mess? It's beyond anything that you ever thought would happen? You're like, how did I get here? Oh, Lord, how did I get here? And he's like, well, you didn't listen to me when we started 3 years ago. And I just knocked on the door to your heart. And you wouldn't answer. So I began pounding. And you wouldn't answer. So I sent a flood. You wouldn't answer. So I sent a fire. You wouldn't answer. So I sent armies. You won't answer. Now you won't listen. That's what he's saying here. I don't know about you guys. I relate. I'm like, God, I know. I choose to be deaf sometimes, Lord. I know you're knocking. I know you're talking to me. I just don't want to hear it. And then I wonder why things are going awry. You know, God says he will not withhold the consequences of our sin from us. You know, I may be a believer and I'm not going to be punished for my sin, but I will still face the consequences of it. Make no doubt about it. And you want to keep living in it, God says eventually I'll turn you over to it. That's a bad day. That's a bad day when God turns you over to that. But you see the point? What was the point? That we would return to him. God wants to bless us. He doesn't want to punish it. He doesn't want to do this. And did it ever say, and God said, it made me smile to do this to you. I was happy to do this to you. No, all I can see is a loving parent having to go to such extremes. Anybody had a rebellious child? That dog of yours? And they just won't listen. They just won't listen. And you try and you try and do it. And so, well, I'm going to ground you for a day. I'm taking away your Nintendo. And now I'm grounding you for a month and you don't get the car. And now it's like you ain't going anywhere till you graduate from high school. You ain't going anywhere till what do you do? I mean, what do you do? I can't beat you anymore. I came from that generation. We got beatings. We didn't get whoopings. We got beatings. Sometimes they worked, sometimes they didn't. Most time they didn't. They didn't. I admit it. But you see, you know, God loves us so much, he'll go to extremes. He'll go to as extreme as he can to get us to simply turn back to him. It's a loving God. He says, yet you have not returned to me. And then he says this, prepare to meet your God. I don't know about you guys, but when you hear that, what connotation comes to mind? Do you hear it like this? Prepare to meet your God. Jess, prepare to meet your God. It's going to be wonderful. Or Rocky, prepare to meet your God. Right. Or that's like this. It could be I bring you up and I serve you papers and I say, David, prepare to meet your God this Thursday at 2:00. I look at it three ways. It's either a challenge. It's like a general challenging his enemy and says, prepare to meet your God. Or the next one's like, it's a friend. It's a friend going, hey, Jess, prepare to meet your God. It's like a friend going to meet your friend. Or the other one's like maybe a summons. You've been indicted. And now it's you're going to have to go and give an account for your life. You know, we can look at this. We need to take this to heart. Are you prepared to meet your God? Are you? Which one of these is, when you hear that, which one are you? Or is it an invitation, a challenge, or a summons? We should be a woohoo, yeah. But you see there, are you prepared? Have you done what you needed to do in order to meet your God? If I'm in Israel's shoes right now, I'm not prepared. I don't want to meet my God at this point in time. Do you want to meet the Creator? He says, the guy that you're going to meet, let's talk about the God you're going to meet. For behold, it is he who has formed the mountains. Go look at the Tetons. The God that made those is the God you need to be prepared to meet. He's the one that also creates the wind. He's the one who declares to man what his thought is and makes the morning darkness. He's the one that controls the sun and the moon. He's the one who treads the high places of the earth. The Lord of God, the Lord God of hosts is his name. The God of hosts is the God of armies, of all power. The God of all power is the God. Are you prepared to meet him? So many people in this world goes, oh yeah, I'm ready, I'm good. I'm a good person. I'm ready to meet that God. Yeah, I'm prepared. I say think again. Be cautious. He is the God of all power. The Lord of hosts is his name. You know, the best preparation we can do, the best preparation is get to know his son. Get to know his son. Have a relationship, a friendship, an intimacy with his son. Because then you know what you'll have to do is just show up. And Jesus will stand in front of you and say, Dad, this is my friend. I know him. His name's David. He's a little rough around the edges, but I like him, and I love him, and he believes in me. And God will say, bring him in. Bring him in, son. We prepared a place for him at the table. Yeah. Really, that's the only preparation you have. You don't want to go in there with a list of good things you've done. God will look at all those and go, "I that means nothing to me. As a matter of fact, all that, I gave you all that. And half the time you used it for yourself. No. The only thing you need to bring with you is your I know Jesus card. And Jesus knows me. That's it. The blood on the cross is where we met. The foot of the cross is where we met and became friends. Are you prepared to meet your God? The Lord of hosts is his name. And he says, hear this word, which I take up against you, lamentation, O house of Israel. The virgin of Israel has fallen. She will rise no more. She lies forsaken on her land. There is no one to raise her up. Okay, how many of you guys, y'all like those romance novels, movies? There's the beautiful green valley below, and there's this beautiful, gorgeous heroine in this white, billowy dress. And she's got long, flowing hair. And she's been fighting against her enemies. And it looks dark and bleak. And she's up there on this precipice. And finally, she falls. And the next thing we expect is, the knight in shining armor comes riding up, right? And he's got that flowing hair and those muscles. And he comes and he saves her, right? He picks her up, puts her on his horse, and they ride off together. And the end. No, that's not the picture here. The picture here is her dress is torn. She's been beating to a pulp. She's fallen flat on the ground. Her enemies have surrounded her. And there is no knight in shining armor coming. All is lost. She's done. Who wants to go see that movie? That's what, there is no one to raise her up. It's over. All is lost. He says, for thus says the Lord, the city that goes out by 1,000 shall have 100 left. And that which goes out by 100 shall have 10 left to the house of Israel. He says, the destruction is going to be so bad, there's only going to be 1 in 10 survive. That's bad odds, folks. It's bad. Have we yet returned to the Lord? He says, for thus says the Lord of the house of Israel, here's the answer. Seek me and live. Seek me and live. But do not seek Bethel, nor enter Gilgal, nor pass over to Beersheba. For Gilgal shall surely go into captivity, and Bethel shall come to nothing. Okay. You remember Bethel? Bethel is where Jacob wrestled with God, where he struggled with God, remember? And he saw the vision of the ladder and the angels ascending and descending. It was a picture of Christ coming into the earth. And he said, surely I have struggled with God and lived. And he said, I shall name this place Bethel, the house of God. That's what Bethel means. Beth means house. El means God. Bethel, house of God. Well, that's wonderful, isn't it? That's an amazing thing that took place in Bethel. Well, what about Gilgal? Well, Gilgal is the first city where Joshua and the children of Israel, when they first came into the promised land, they stopped at Gilgal, made camp, and got themselves right with God before they marched into the land to fight the giants. An amazing place at Gilgal, Joshua chapter 4. They stopped there and they got themselves right with God. That's a good place to be, right? Hopefully we all got a Gilgal in our lives. That's where I stopped and I got myself right with God. And then Beersheba. Beersheba's an ancient place that Abraham, there was stuff went on there with Abraham and Isaac and Jacob. And many wonderful things happened in Beersheba. But yet God says, do not go there. Don't go to Bethel thinking you're going to find me there. Don't go to Gilgal thinking that you're going to have wonderful experiences there with me. And surely don't go to Beersheba. The point that God is making is this. Yeah, wonderful things may have happened there at one time. But now they are places of false worship. Nobody is finding me there anymore. Nobody is worshiping me there anymore. They may be having parties and church services like you've never seen. It's Easter every Sunday. But nobody's hearts are turned towards God. Nobody has repented of their sin. Nobody is earnestly seeking God. They're just going through. The worship is great, by the way. But nobody's thinking about God. Ikes. Seek me and live. You don't need to go to Gilgal. Reminds me of Jesus. You remember when Jesus met the Samaritan woman at the John chapter 4? Met her at the well. And she said, and he started telling her all about her life, right? And she says, I perceive you're a prophet. And he says, yeah. And she says, well, you know, the Jews say you got to go to Jerusalem and worship, but we worship on that high mountain over there. And she says, but I know there's a time coming when the Messiah is going to come, and we will neither worship there or in Jerusalem. And Jesus said, yeah, that's right. And that time is now. There's no more need to go to Jerusalem. There's no more need to go to the high mountains. Because guess what? You need to seek me and live. Churches are wonderful, and we have need of them, and they have their place in all of this. And God, please save souls in this building. But this building holds nothing special. It's not holy. It's not well, I hope it's set apart for the service of God, yes, but it's not, there's nothing, if there's anything supernatural here, if there's any saving power here, it's the Lord and Him alone. We could tear down all the walls, move out all the chairs, strip it down to its bare, there's nothing special about this place. I love it when people come and they say, I found the Lord here back in 1958. Praise God. You made a pilgrimage back to Kanab, to this old building? Sometimes they do, you know. But it's really the Lord, right? It's the Lord. It's Jesus that saved you. And he doesn't dwell in buildings made with hands. He dwells in hearts and lives of people. But you see, when we replace that for this, boy, we're selling ourselves short. We're settling for something far less than God wants for us. And that's why he tells them, don't go to there, don't go to those places. I'm not there. I'm not there. Seek me and live. Verse 6, seek the Lord and live, lest he break out like fire in the house of Joseph and devour it, with no one to quench it in Bethel. You who turn justice to wormwood. Wormwood, something that's spoiled and bitter. You turn justice, it's spoiled and it's bitter. He says, and you lay righteousness to rest in the earth. You buried it. You buried righteousness as if it's some dead thing. Justice and righteousness. Going to talk a lot more about that. He says, for he made Pleiades and Orion. He turns the shadow of death into mourning, not grieving, but mourning, like rising light. He makes the day dark as night. He calls for the waters of the sea and pours them out on the face of the earth. The Lord is his name. He rains ruin upon the strong so that fury comes upon the fortress. They hate the one who rebukes in the gate, and they abhor the one who speaks uprightly. Therefore, because you tread down the poor and you take grain taxes from him, though you have built houses of hewn stone, yet you shall not dwell in them. You have planted pleasant vineyards, but you shall not drink wine from them. For I know your manifold transgressions and your mighty sins, afflicting the just and taking bribes, diverting the poor from justice at the gate. Therefore, the prudent keeps silent at that time. Okay, he says, they hate the one who rebukes in the gate. In the ancient cities, the gate, where you walk into the city, and there's a chair, and it's set upon this platform. That is where court is held. And the mayor of the city and the nobles of the city are there, and they sit there and they hear your case, right? But what's going on is the poor people, the upright people, know that there is no justice to be found there. As a matter of fact, if I go there and I speak righteousness, they're going to throw me under the bus because they don't want to hear it. They hate the one who rebukes in the gate. They abhor the one who speaks uprightly. Boy, if this doesn't fit where we're at today. People screaming injustice in our judicial system. And there is no justice when justice is delayed and withheld. I'll mention that. That's God's word says. Where justice is delayed, justice is denied. We spend more time on lawyers and we know they're guilty of sin. And you won't do it. You let them loose. You turn murderers loose on us. They do. I'm sorry. And people that don't deserve to go to jail are going to jail. This is not the platform for this, but let me just say, this is God's word here. This was going on in Israel at the time. When people are murdered and murderers go free, and those that murder them go free, it's injustice. And if you're upright, I don't know about you guys, but you want to stand before the judge and tell him he's unrighteous? How do you think? Yeah, Tom knows how that's going to go. Not well. You see, it was going on then. It's going on now. Nothing's changed. The more it changes, the more it stays the same. This is, but God says, because of this, he says, I know what's going on. I know what's going on, and I am going to judge you for it. Do not think you will escape it. I will hold you accountable. And then he goes, you know, it's a sad, verse 13 is a sad verse. Therefore, the prudent keep silent at that time. They know they should speak out, but they know it ain't going to do them any good. So they just zip it. Yeah. Why? For it is an evil time. For it is an evil time. You know, my heart breaks to see what's going on in our nation today. Those aren't protesters. Those are rioters. There are people protesting, yes. A protest, you make up your little sign and you go have a love sit down and at the courthouse or, you know. What happened in Minneapolis was a tragedy. Should not have happened. What happened in Georgia was a tragedy. Should not have happened. We could go on and on and on. It is an evil time. To think that people are going to do right without the Lord, that's a pipe dream. So what's the solution for you and I? Not the world. That's God's problem. That's God's issue. Let's leave that for God to deal with, okay? But for you and I, when we're confronted with all this, what's the solution for us? It's verse 14. Seek good and not evil, that you may live. So the Lord God of hosts will be with you. So the Lord of all power will be with you if you seek good and not evil. God will be with you. But if you seek evil and not good in situations like this, God will not be with you. He says, as you have spoken, hate evil, love good, establish justice in the gate. It may be that the Lord God of hosts will be gracious to the remnant of Jacob. You know, trying to remember here. You know, Jesus talking with the Pharisees. He said, you guys will strain out a gnat and you'll swallow a camel. You'll tithe of mint and all these other herbs, but you'll forsake mercy and justice. The weightier things. He said, you know, the things that really are important to God. When we seek good, we should mercy and justice. Mercy and justice. Those are good things. They go hand in hand, folks. Right? We should be merciful to people, but also seeking justice in all of this. You know, hate evil. Hate evil. I was watching some guys tearing off the plywood off some guy's store. He's just some guy. I don't even know who the guy is. I don't know what maybe he sells, t-shirts. He just got a little t-shirt shop there. And these guys are just doing all they can. He took the time to board up his store to protect it. It's his livelihood. It's his life. He's just an American trying to make a living. And these guys are up there, I swear, like wild animals trying to tear off the plywood. I was really pleased because he must have done a good job. There must have been 3-inch screws in there because they couldn't budge it. And the guy walked away that was trying to, he was so disgusted, he kicked the plywood. And I was like, I hope he broke his foot. I hope he walks with a limp and remembers that. Because he was doing evil. He was doing evil. He wasn't seeking the goodness of that poor guy that just, he hasn't no dog in this hunt. He's just a normal Joe. And he's caught in the middle of all of this. And yet, that's not justice. That's not mercy. I wonder how many of those people we see out there call themselves Christians in the midst of all this. Shame on them. Shame on them. If that's their testimony, shame on them. Hate evil and love good. Establish justice in the gate. Maybe the Lord of hosts will be gracious to us. Therefore, verse 16, the Lord God of hosts of the Lord says this, there shall be wailing in all the streets. They shall say in all the highways, alas, alas. They shall call the farmer to mourning, and the skillful lamenters to wailing. In all the vineyards there shall be wailing, for I will pass through you, says the Lord. He says the devastation is going to be so great, there's going to be a lack of people to grieve over the loss of life. We're going to hire farmers to be professional grievers. You remember that was a custom way back then at funerals. If you came from a small family, you could hire lamenters to come and lament at your funerals. Professional wailers. That's what I want. I want Bob Marley and the Wailers to come wail at my funerals. Mass is not a idea. Sorry. Forgive me. He says that's how bad it's going to be. There's not going to be enough people to mourn and grieve over the loss. And you know what? It was. The Assyrians, when they came through, just annihilated Israel. He says, now this is a warning for us here today. He says, woe to you who desire the day of the Lord. For what good is the day of the Lord to you? It will be darkness and not light. He says, so a lot of people in Israel at that time were praying for the day of the Lord, when the Lord would come and avenge them against their enemies. They're like, the day of the Lord, boy, that's going to be a good day for us. He's going to avenge us. Guess what? There's a lot of people today praying for the day of the Lord. But the Lord says to him, he says, woe to you if you desire that day. Maybe you're not quite right with me. Be careful. He says, for what good is the day of the Lord to you? Whoa. That's some pretty... He says, you're in the midst of your sin. You're unrepentant. The day of the Lord comes, you keep praying for it, you don't really want it. It will be darkness and not light. It will be as though a man fled from a lion and a bear met him. And as though he went into the house and he leaned his hand on the wall and a serpent bit him. Is not the day of the Lord darkness and not light? It is not. It is very dark with no brightness in it. He's like, it's going to be so bad that the lion's going to be chasing you. And if you get away from the lion, you're going to run into a bear. And if you escape from the bear and you get into your house and you're like, boy, that was a close one. Put your hand on the wall and there's a snake and he bites you. The point is, there's no escaping. You can run, but you can't hide. There's no escaping the judgment that's coming. Now, verse 21, he says, I despise your feast days. Whoa. I do not savor your sacred assemblies. Though you offer me burnt offerings and your grain offerings, I will not accept them. Nor will I regard your fattened peace offerings. Take away from me the noise of your songs. For I will not hear the melody of your stringed instruments, but let justice run down like water and righteousness like a mighty stream. Did you offer me sacrifices and offerings in the wilderness 40 years, O house of Israel? The answer is no, they did not. He says, you also carried Sukkoth, your king, and Chayan, your idols, the star of your gods, which you made for yourselves. Therefore, I will send you into captivity beyond Damascus, says the Lord, whose name is the God of hosts. Excuse me. Yes, they did offer sacrifices in the wilderness to the Lord, but they were also carrying around with them pagan idols. Do you know that? God had brought them out of the land of Egypt, saved them from bondage, saved them from sin, was providing for them daily, had given them this wonderful law. It was wonderful. The law is wonderful. It's good. It's a blessing when it's done appropriately. And yet, they were still dragging around pagan idols with them. And God didn't squish them. Well, that generation he did. But it wasn't for that. It was for their unfaithfulness when they went into the land. And they came back and they lied about it. But do you see this? So, is the answer to our problems more religion? We just need more religion to make us right with God. Just a little more church. A few more rituals. No. God says, at this point in time, he's looking at his people, and he says, I hate your religion. I despise it. It does nothing for me. As a matter of fact, don't even sing me another song. I don't want to hear it. It's an affront to me. Oh, gosh, God forbid we would ever get to that place in our lives, that would be who we are before God. I realize we've got issues, I've got problems. I'm just not quite there yet, Lord. I know that. There's still a lot of work to be done in my heart, my life. But God, please don't take your spirit from me. Don't turn away from me when I'm practicing my meager religion before you. And forgive me when I'm preoccupied by my own life in the world and I don't give you preeminence in my life on Sunday morning and Wednesday night, let alone all day Tuesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday. Please forgive me, Lord. I don't want to be that before you. I want to be faithful. I want to be the one that Jesus looks at and says, oh, my good and faithful servant, you have served me well. Come in and dine with me. And I'm sure all of you want that in your life as well, too. But we can't have that if we don't listen to God, if we don't agree with God, if we don't follow after God, if we don't seek him first and foremost over all of this stuff. Thank you for the buildings. We just planted wonderful grass out around the youth building. It's gorgeous. It's going to be such a wonderful blessing to the children, I pray. I pray that kids for the next umpteen generations just trash that yard. Pull down rock. They're going to be climbing in Rocky's trees and breaking off limbs and that they might grow up serving the Lord faithfully. In prayer, we just wear out this building, just serving the Lord for his glory, and we just give him preeminence in all of our lives. Don't you want that, church? Amen, amen. And so, Father, thank you, Lord, for this time. Thank you for your word. Yes, it's hard, Lord. It's sometimes it feels so condemning and so judgmental, and yet I know in my heart of hearts that your desire is that I would simply return to you, that I would seek you, Lord, that I would live. That's your desire, is that we would live and that we would not face that judgment. Israel had opportunity, Lord, to turn from their sins, to repent, and yet they chose not to. And the choice is up to us today as well, Lord. We can choose to listen to you. If you're speaking to our hearts about something in our lives, God, we can choose to listen to you and to submit to you and say, Lord, help me. Help me to repent of my sin and turn to you. Or we can choose to simply ignore you. Lord, the choice is ours. I pray that we would seek you, Lord, that we might live. So, Lord, your word says that, it says, what shall I come? With what shall I come with before the Lord? When I bow before God on high, should I come to him with burnt offerings, with year-old calves? Would the Lord be pleased with 1,000 rams or 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I present my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? But he has shown me what is good. And what does the Lord require of me but to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with my God? And so, Lord, help us to do that. Lord, help us to act justly, even in the worst situations. Lord, help us to love mercy, even when justice needs to be done. And Lord, help us to walk humbly with you each and every day of our lives, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you all. Thank you.